Hello, everyone. Welcome here in another Moodle webinar, Moodle Academy webinar. The webinar is called today Introduction to Instructional Design. And with us, we have today Anastasia Mavraki, who is a master, has a master in education and is an instructional designer, and Felipe Londoño from Buen Data, Moodle partner, a pedagogical advisor. Anastasia is going to talk about the learning theories, the importance of planning and community of inquiry. And Felipe is going to give us an input from Data Curso, a very interesting platform that can help all educators in the instructional design process. Anastasia, over to you.
A warm welcome from me too. I'm Anastasia Mavraki, instructional designer and e-learning specialist, and I'm here with you today to discuss learning theories and especially the main principles that help us understand which of their elements we can adapt in our online or blended learning courses. Creating our personal mix towards the accomplishment of our learning goals and also for addressing the needs of a specific target group. The up-to-date research offers us so many valuable insights on how we can benefit from its theory, while how we can practically embed them in the design of our learning experiences. So let's start with the oldest of learning theories, the behaviorism. As one of the older personality theories, behaviorism can be attributed to Descartes, who introduced the concept of stimulus. A stimulus is an external event. So in this theory, human is considered as a machine, dependent on external events, and whose soul is the ghost in the machine, because it's something unobservable. Although most theories work to a certain extent on the assumption that people have some sort of free will and moral thinking, behaviorists refuse to accept the individual's inner processes. In behaviorist's mind, human is nothing more than a mere mediator between behavior and the environment. So behaviorism in its actual name was introduced by John Watson in the early of 20th century, who was the first that attempted to form a consistent learning theory, at least in the modern Western society. Variations have emerged in the next decades by many researchers, including Thorndike, Tolman, Guthrie, Hull, Skinner, and others. From the viewpoint of the behaviorists, behavior can be observed whereas internal mental processes cannot. That's why Watson called them as the black box. When learning occurs, then some kind of external behavior will be observed, studied, and measured objectively by more than one researcher at the same time. For this reason, behavior is also known as stimulus response psychology, which means behaviorism focuses on how the correlation between the stimulus and the response is formed, strengthened and maintained, and is not concerned about metacognition, mental processes, or memory. Therefore, behavior can be modified just by manipulating the environment, while periodical repetition and practice maintain the learner's readiness to react. Behavioral theories define motivation as an increased rate or probability of occurrence of behavior, which results from repeating behaviors in response to stimuli, or as a consequence of reinforcement. Skinner's operant conditioning theory contains no new principles to account for motivation. Motivated behavior is increased or continued responding is produced by reinforcement. Students display motivated behavior because they previously were reinforced for it and because effective reinforcers are present. Behavioral theories do not distinguish motivation from learning, but rather use the same principles to explain all behavior. So, as instructional designers, behavioral theorists believe that the work of the tutor and instructional designer is to identify the triggers that cause the desirable responses, organize training situations in which motivation will be associated with target stimuli, which initially have no induced power, but are expected to cause responses in the context of a natural environment. to create appropriate environmental situations so that students can provide the desirable responses according to the target stimuli and receive feedback. These strategies have generally proved to be credible and effective in facilitating learning that includes discrimination, which is recalling events, generalizations, which is definition and representation of ideas, correlations, which is application of explanations, and chain reaction, which is the automatic execution of a specific process. However, it is generally assumed that behavioral principles cannot fully explain the acquisition of higher level competencies or those that require deeper processing, such as language development, problem solving, and critical thinking. That's why we are going to pass to cognitivism. Cognitive learning theories deal with the processes that take place inside the brain and also with the neuroscience of learning, something that behaviorism doesn't do. Cognitivists believe that human actively processes information. Thus, learning is a result of learners' efforts. Internal mental processes include the introduction, organization, storage, recall, and correlation between information. New information is associated with past knowledge and schemata. In the early of the 20th century, some efforts were made to organize cognitive theories, but at that time, more attention was paid to behavioral investigations. Only after the Second World War, cognitive theories began to become popular. Gestalt psychologists first criticized behaviorism and emphasized on perception, insight, and meaning as the key elements of learning. The learner was considered as a perceptual organism that organized, interpreted, and gave meaning to events that contradicted his conscience. The rationalization of events and phenomena was the motivation of learning. The student made sense of things by thinking about them, not just executing them. So for Gestalt supporters, students' individuality and internal mental processes are of the utmost importance. Jean Piaget was influenced by behaviorist and Gestalt schools and suggested that internal mental structures change as a result of developmental changes in the neurological system and exposure to a variety of experiences and environments that include them. Modern theoreticians of cognitivism, such as Ausubel, Brunner, and Gagné, of course, emphasized on the various points of cognitive function in individual and group contexts. Their common point was that internal mental processes are of major importance. And although Ausubel, Brunner, and Gagné viewed learning differently, they all contributed significantly to the overall model of human learning. Ausubel, for example, took into account the influence of prior knowledge, a factor that had not been taken into account by behaviorists. And he created a tool he called the Advanced Organizer. Later, Brunner's research into hierarchic categorization of ideas provided models of how the student perceives information from the environment. And Gagné explored the events of learning and instruction as a series of phases using the cognitive steps of coding, storing, recalling, and transferring information. So, according to cognitivism, humans are not programmed animals that react to environmental stimuli in the same way. Instead, human is a sensible being whose action is a consequence of thought. Cognitivism, like behaviorism, emphasizes on the role that environmental conditions play in the learning process. Instructions, explanations, presentations, examples are the guiding principles of the student. Similarly, the role of exercise accompanied by reinforcing feedback is emphasized. Cognitive theories believe that environmental factors alone cannot justify learning. Additional elements are required, such as the way the student captures, encodes, converts, stores, and of course, reflects information. So as instructional designers, cognitivists use feedback to guide and support the learner in order to make mental connections and observe learners' attitude towards learning. They also use techniques such as advanced organizers, proportions, hierarchical correlations, and tables to help the learners in connecting prior knowledge with new information. Accordingly, some of the basic elements that prevail in cognitive instructional design are, first of all, the emphasis on learners' active participation in the educational process. The conditional knowledge, which allows the learners to be aware of facts and procedures respectively. The use of hierarchical analysis to identify and visualize prerequisites to achieve the learning goals. And of course, we shouldn't omit that they observe metacognition, how they know what they know, the metacognition knowledge, and how it influences learning. They create learning environments that allow and empower students to create links to pre-existing knowledge. And now let's proceed to a more synchronous and adventurous learning theory through implementation, but also very challenging. And we are talking about constructivism. In constructivism, learners are the protagonists of the learning experience, since knowledge derives from collaboration and cultural exchange. This reciprocal fashion turns all participants into active learners who develop knowledge for themselves by creating their own mix of activities in their own level and context. Specifically, the notions of activity, idea, and context are the three important elements in constructivism. And we are talking about situated cognition because the cognitive processes are directly related to the person and the situation each time. And we shouldn't also omit the principle of exploratory learning, which is congruent with the theory of situated learning and involves interaction between the learners and the content through problem-based situations. So experience is difficult to define in constructivism, but that's why the tutor creates the appropriate experiences as advanced organizers in order to form a base of knowledge first, according to the course objectives. Therefore, knowledge will not be just some disconnected pieces. They are presented partially and in hierarchical order with main purpose to reinforce discovery learning. Students learn more effectively and save information in their LMS when they discover something on their own, and instructions lead to this way. In no case, we could say that constructivist learning occurs randomly. Active exploration was recommended by Piaget and is compatible with discovery learning. Constructivist theorists believe that scientific truths wait for discovery and verification. Therefore, learning occurs when learners make knowledge their own possession. They have ownership of their learning by discovering it and constructing it rather than by having the content delivered by the teacher. So in the same way, we can talk about social constructivism. So unlike Piaget's notion that children's development must necessarily precede their learning, Vygotsky, who introduced social constructivism, argued that learning is a necessary and universal aspect of the process of developing culturally organized, specifically human psychological function. In other words, social learning tends to precede development. A key concept that he introduced is the zone of proximal development, defined as the distance between the actual developmental level as determined by independent problem solving and the level of potential development as determined through problem solving under adult guidance or in collaboration with more capable peers. So the zone of proximal development represents the amount of learning possible, the potential by a student given the proper instructional conditions. It shows how learning and development are related and can be viewed as an alternative to the conception of intelligence. In the zone of proximal development, a teacher and a learner work together on a task that the learner could not perform independently because of the difficulty level. The zone of proximal development reflects the Marxist idea of collective activity in which those who know more or are more skilled share that knowledge and skill to accomplish a task with those who know less, so they function as proctors. However, the zone of proximal development should not be confined just on the notion of scaffoldings, which is the help and guidance that a teacher can provide to the learner. It's merely based on social interactions that bring cultural exchange. Learners bring their own understandings to these social interactions and construct new meanings by integrating those understandings with their experiences in the context. So as instructional designers, constructivists must use real problem situations, which is really challenging, scenario-based learning. And they have to observe phenomena because they are going to test hypotheses. Nothing is taken for granted. And they have to take in mind the context of the learners, of course. So the content must be properly situated. Helping students acquire cognitive mediators, such as signs, symbols, through the social environment can be accomplished in many ways. A common application involves the concept of instructional scaffolding, which refers to the process of controlling task elements that are beyond the learner's capabilities, so that they can focus on and master those features of the task that they can grasp quickly. To use an analogy of scaffolding employed in construction projects, instructional scaffolding has five major functions: provide support, function as a tool, extend the range of the learner, permit the attainment of tasks not otherwise possible, and use selectively only as needed. So in a learning situation, a teacher initially might do most of the work, after which the teacher and the learners share responsibility. As learners become more competent, the teacher gradually withdraws the scaffoldings so learners can perform independently. And the key is to ensure that the scaffolding keeps learners in their potential, in their zone of proximal development, which is raised as they develop capabilities, of course. And also an important application area is peer collaboration, which reflects the notion of collective activity. We must take into account that learning does not occur in isolation. So in the light of the above, it's worth mentioning that different learning theories allow us to view teaching and learning from different perspectives. More specifically, behaviorism views the mind as a black box and promotes that learning is based on regular expected responses. Instruction, according to behaviorists, is based on repetition and reinforcement. Also, practice is vital in order to reach mastery. But cognitivism views the mind as a computer and therefore supports that learning is based on recall of stored information. Instruction, according to cognitivism, is based on gaining learners' attention and then assisting them to understand the meaning of new concepts and store the information so that it's available for later recall. Behaviorism answers to the question of what has to be learned, whereas cognitivism answers to the question of how it can be learned. And then constructivism adds this type of higher order thinking skills, which helps the learners build knowledge and create objects relevant to their context and interests. It promotes collaborative learning and reinforces activities that add value to instructional design, such as project-based learning, branching scenarios, and peer evaluation. It is worth mentioning here that behaviorism is not old-fashioned at all, as we all think. It's involved with defining clear learning objectives, which is very important. It's involved with computer-assisted instruction, programmed instruction with predetermined paths by the computer, or even branching scenarios where, although we claim freedom of choice, learners follow predefined paths there too. Accordingly, in instructional design, two types of theories emerge. We have a descriptive theories, which describe what learning is, and the prescriptive theories, which provide methods for fostering and enhancing learning and are based on the tenets of the aforementioned learning theories. And as we've developed the learning theories, it's important to understand how we can apply them in instruction. And of course, understand what is instruction at first. So as you will see on this quote, instruction is part of education because all instruction consists of experiences leading to learning. So what instructional designers do They create learning experiences just like an architect. To understand the importance of instructional design and planning the learning experiences, let's delve into a case study first. Let's say we have Peter Bontevail, who is in a conference with three co-workers at an airline company. So Mr. Bontevail and his team are figuring out the exact nature of the learning that air crew members need in order to improve the safety of the company's flights. The areas of required learning have already been established, and now the team is breaking those learning tasks down into the components and prerequisites. Peter and his team are using some techniques from instructional design to guide their work. So the term instructional design refers to the systematic and reflective process of translating principles of learning and instruction into plans. Plans for instructional materials, activities, information resources, and evaluation. So an instructional designer is somewhat like an engineer. Both plan their work based upon principles that have been successful in the past. The engineer on the laws of physics and the designer on basic principles of instruction and learning. Both try to design solutions that are not only functional, but also attractive or appealing to the end user. Both the engineer and instructional designer have established problem-solving procedures that they use to guide them in making decisions about their designs. So careful, systematic planning is important no matter what media of instruction are used in the implementation. When the medium of instruction is something other than a teacher, and when it's possible that a teacher may not be available or prepared to compensate for poorly planned instructional materials, careful instructional design is critical. So instruction is the intentional facilitation of learning toward identified learning goals. In all definitions, instruction is the intentional arrangement of experiences leading to learners acquiring particular capabilities. These capabilities can vary qualitatively in form, from simple recall of knowledge to cognitive strategies that allow a learner to find new problems within a field of study. For example, a teacher or trainer may wish to help learners use a particular kind of computer software to solve a certain set of problems. The instructional designer will develop materials and activities that are intended to prepare the learners to use the software effectively. That's why the factor of meaningful instruction comes to the table now. What must we have in mind? First of all, is the reason of instruction. In educational settings, the existence of effective and efficient instruction is critical. More specifically, it's important that education consists of a series of experiences that leads to the accomplishment of the learning goals in a timely and cost-effective manner. This is very important. An instructional designer can serve these purposes and develop a syllabus for a new course, which is planned to be introduced in an organization, review the existing syllabus to give feedback, and provide examples of other syllabi that were proved to be effective. As for the types of instructional theories, of course, different learning theories display various criteria that define the efficiency of instruction. In every situation of instructional theories, there is a different prescription according to the course objectives, the learners, and the setting. Just like the doctor provides us with a different prescription according to the situation. So a job of the instructional designer is to be observant and take into account every variable that affects learning. In the light of the above, the first thing that must be stressed here is that instruction is necessary for ill-defined problems in educational settings. Initially, instructional designers conduct a needs assessment, the first stage and very important stage, with the purpose to find out the problematic situation and determine if there is a need for instruction. As Smith and Ragan point, they say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Otherwise, vain instruction could lead to pointless investments by the stakeholders and to non-responsive courses. That's why there are three questions that we must definitely have in mind. Where are we going? How will we get there? And how will we know when we have arrived? Keep in mind these three questions all the time. These are the major activities that an instructional designer completes during the design and the development process. For the first question, during the activity, the designers will learn as much as they can about the environment in which the learners will be trained, about the learners themselves, and about the repair tasks for which the learners must be prepared. In the second question, how will we get there? During this activity, the designers determine the way that instructional material is related to the topic. They also decide which learning activities the learners can experience. And when it comes to how will we know when we have arrived, when designing the evaluation, because it's about evaluation, the designers plan an approach for evaluating the instructional materials to determine what kinds of changes need to be made in them. Some of the questions that may be asked include the following. Is the content accurate? What materials learners should use? Should students be observed one at a time, or in groups? And a lot more, of course. So in order to see how we are going to proceed with an instructional design model and answer to these three questions, we are going to analyze the ADDIE model. And although there are a lot of instructional design models, ADDIE model is the most straightforward of instructional design models because it provides a clear process for the course design, which is not linear though. When you design learning experiences, it's inevitable to go back and forth in order to align the learning goals and the material with the actual needs of the learners. So you can see here the diagram of the ADDIE model. It has to do with the analysis, looking clockwise, of course, design, development, implementation, and evaluation. And just summarizing a little bit about what each phase contains. When it comes to needs analysis, a needs analysis should be conducted at the start of any development effort to determine whether training is required to fill a gap in professional knowledge and skills, and whether e-learning is the best solution to deliver the training. The needs analysis allows the identification of general high-level course goals. We also, in this process, have the target audience analysis, a crucial step. The design and delivery of e-learning will be influenced by key characteristics of the learners. For example, their previous knowledge and skills, their geographical provenience, learning context, and access to technology. Analysis also is needed to determine the course content. And then we have task analysis, which identifies the job tasks that learners should learn or improve, and the knowledge and skills that need to be developed or reinforced. This type of analysis is mainly used in courses designed to build specific job-related skills, also called perform courses. We can either have topic analysis carried out to identify and classify the course content. This is typical of those courses that are primarily designed to provide information, also called inform courses. But you are always going to have the content template. You are going to find it in our course material too. And there you can analytically see the details of your target audience, the task analysis, and the topic analysis. It needs a little practice. Then we have the design stage where you just have to determine the general capacity course objective and the sub-learning objectives, and also the learning outcomes, which are the actions that show if the learners have conquered the learning goals. So in this stage, the e-learning content is actually produced. The content can vary considerably depending on the available resources. For example, e-learning content may consist of only simpler materials. For example, those with little or no interactivity, or some multimedia, such as structured PDF documents, which can be combined with other materials, audio or video files, assignments, and tests. So in the development phase, the development of multimedia and interactive content is comprised of three main steps. The actual content development, which is writing or collecting all the required knowledge and information. And then we put them all in a storyboard. We have the storyboard development, where we integrate all instructional methods and we put them in a document that describes all the components of the final interactive products. And then we have the courseware development, which is all the interactive components, the media, the audio, the different formats of CD-ROM and web delivery. And we integrate them in the LMS or in a learning platform that learners can access. And in the implementation phase, the course is delivered to the learners. It's the actual delivery. The courseware is installed on a server and made accessible for learners. So in facilitated and instructor-led courses, this stage also includes managing and facilitating learners' activities. In other words, the implementation phase develops procedures for training facilitators and learners. And then we go to the evaluation. Any learning project can be evaluated for specific evaluation purposes. You may want to evaluate learners' reactions, the achievement of learning objectives, the transfer of job-related knowledge and skills, and the impact of the project on the organization. It always depends on the situation and the target audience. The evaluation phase consists of two aspects, the formative and the summative one. Formative evaluation is present in each stage of the ADDIE process, while summative evaluation is conducted on finished instructional programs or products. And here, you can also visit later, is the areas of responsibility for each stage, very important diagram, because it helps organizations, companies to see which stakeholder each time will have a role in the process. And if we talk a little bit further about the needs analysis, we just have to focus on three aspects. So let's go back to our case study and talk about the first challenge that Peter faced at the beginning of their project. It was that he needed to conduct a needs assessment for a setting with ill-defined problems. He was required to find out a problematic situation and determine if there was a need for instruction. So therefore, he set some critical questions such as, who says there's a problem? Who is affected by the problem? Which evaluated the situation and accordingly the actual existence of the problem. Then he became a detective and conducted qualitative research, examining the view of some of their colleagues in the work environment in order to determine the existence of a gap. This time-consuming process led to the creation of a course that could be promoted in the real work context. So there are many reasons that can result in unsuccessful training. A basic one is when instructional designers have not analyzed the characteristics of the target audience and have created training that is not effective and interesting. That's why we have to bear in mind learner characteristics, which can be divided in four major categories, cognitive, physiological, affective, and social. And you can elaborate more, of course, in the files of our course, because we have all the sources and the questions that we can pose in order to learn more information about learners' characteristics. So here, you can also revisit the slides later. We have gathered for you some methods, some research methods that show how to find more about the learners that we have never met. You can conduct research by interviews, interviewing members or other stakeholders. You can even examine job descriptions posted in the past and show important characteristics of the target audience of the training. You can read text and articles about particular age groups or text and articles that discuss the interests and motivations of individuals. Finishing our case study, we come to this conclusion that Peter and Jenny, the instructional designer, found out that there were many trainees who were unable to use the software which the developers had assumed that they were able to. If they hadn't completed a learner analysis, they would not be able to determine what the learners were like and what specific prior knowledge they possessed. They would have provided the training through a mode that learners were not trained to use, and the instruction would be in vain. Many learners would drop out quickly. And fortunately, they had also analyzed the learning task to determine what learners actually need to know in order to complete the required tasks. So that's why we have important steps for a task analysis, which steps lead us to the design phase. The design phase is very important and critical in instructional design because it has to do with learning objectives. And I like this quote so much. It says, learning objectives are small learning promises. In fact, they show to the learners what they are going to learn. So they are short statements that tell your learners what a specific educational offering presents and what they can learn from it. So it's very important to know how to write measurable learning objectives, how to develop a course outline document. This is the document I was referring to that you will find in your course later. So the course outline document is important for an e-learning course because all the information, the process is there. And it's something like a blueprint that gives the real picture. And what is an impact checklist document? To prove that our online or blended learning training has an impact, we need to create a value chain. Which value chain is in this impact checklist? A value chain between strategic objectives and learning. So we have to create a direct link between what is learned during the training and how this is going to bring the change during the work. That's why we have to keep on creating strong learning objectives. Bloom's taxonomy action verbs help us do this. Learning objectives indicate the skills and the knowledge attendees will learn during the training. So if we're talking about higher order thinking skills, we are higher on the pyramid of Bloom's taxonomy. We are here in creating skills, which of course have a lot more demandings. But if we just want our learners to remember something, we are in the lower order thinking skills. That's why here, later you can revisit, you will find the acquisition of knowledge according to Bloom's taxonomy action verbs. These are the cognitive domains. And learning objectives can imply six different types of cognitive performance, ranging from the lowest performance level, which is remember, to the highest, which is creating. So that's why we have guidelines for creating learning objectives. You first have to think about the tasks that the learner will be able to do. And you will create no more than five learning objectives for your course. And then you have the sub-learning objectives, which are aligned to each capacity learning objective of the course. ABCD method, ABCD learning objectives works. It will help you a lot to keep these guidelines effective and create effective learning outcomes for your training programs. So ABCD stands for audience, behavior, condition, and degree. Audience for who are your learners? For example, my learners are customer service representatives. And what will be the desirable behavior that I want them to have? For example, provide a correct and timely response to a customer inquiry. Under what condition? during webinar simulations, and to what degree? 5 times without error. So according to this method, if you connect all these pieces, you will get a solid learning objective. Customer service representatives will provide a correct and timely response to a customer inquiry during webinar simulations 5 times without error. That's why I was referring to the content template before, which is indicative of the level that learning objectives match with the learning outcomes and the assessment criteria. So here you can revisit later. We have a table that will also help you to keep in mind each time what you have to do. What is the capacity learning objective, which is the overall course objective? What are the learning objectives? What are the goals that will be covered there? And the learning outcomes that will be aligned with the learner's actions. So I would like to stress that there is a very helpful tool that will help you connect the learning objectives with the activities and create a map of the processes in your course. The best outcomes are that each activity is defined with a respective color, and this at the end gives you a general impression of the thinking skills that your course includes. And also an amazing thing is that it generates a whole course outline for you in a Word format, or it even creates for you a Moodle course with sections according to the way you separated your activities. In Moodle Academy, you may find other courses on ABC learning design, and Felipe is going to present Data Curso, another useful tool for instructional design. So you will see it, you will delve more into it. That's why the last thing I'm going to analyze a little bit is the guidelines to create very nice learning outcomes and learning objectives. Because some of you may wonder, how am I going to have a guarantee of quality in my instructional design work? Regarding this issue, I would like to refer to these very important quality models in the designing phase: Gagné's 9 events of instruction and the community of inquiry model. Of course, I have for you here specific examples that you can revisit later and understand how you can apply those models in your courses. So Gagné's 9 events of instruction are intended to provide teachers, trainers, instructors, and instructional designers with a set of guidelines to create efficient and effective learning experiences. Each step in Gagné's process provides a communication strategy that is intended to further deepen the human learning process. As each step is completed, learners are meant to become interested, engaged, and invested in the learning topic. Before you begin designing e-learning courses or instructor-led training materials, make sure you read through and apply all of Gagné's guidelines. You can even print out the guidelines and use them as a checklist. So we have to understand that we first have to gain attention of the learner in order to have a nice course. We must inform the learners of the objectives very clearly. We must stimulate and recall of prior learning, which means that learning doesn't take place in a vacuum. We must draw in prior knowledge and skills that learners already have. And I'm reminding you, the how-to here are the examples that you will find later in your presentation. You have to present the content in many different ways to address the learner's needs. You have to provide guidance in order to learning can be effective. Of course, you have to make them apply, elicit performance. And the 7th event, very important, it says providing feedback, because you have to remember the outcomes you set right at the beginnings. You gather and share feedback, and it's part of keeping learners on track. You have to assess performance. So you have to align the goals with the learner's performance. and enhance retention and transfer, which means that you must make learners practice. Practice makes perfect. This way, they can also transfer their learning to another context. And you can also revisit these examples and also have more information about community of inquiry here, which is the second quality model I'm referring to and can consist of an important checklist for you to create your e-learning courses. So what is a community of inquiry? It's an educational community, a group of individuals who collaboratively engage in purposeful critical discourse and reflection to construct personal meaning and confirm mutual understanding. And what does this mean? When we are talking about community of inquiry, we are talking about the perfect balance of social presence, teaching presence, and cognitive presence. As you can see in this diagram here, these three elements have a specific area, which is the safe place for our desirable balance. The social presence has to do with a strong relationship between learning outcomes and collaboration. There are activities that cultivate social presence and also enhance the learner's satisfaction with the internet as an educational delivery medium. That's why when learners collaborate, they have greater opportunities for increased social presence and a greater sense of online community, which also tends to improve the socio-emotional climate in online courses. I have to say that of the three types of presence in the community of inquiry framework, social presence is the most researched, while cognitive presence is the most challenging to study and develop in online courses, because as you can see in this diagram, it has four different categories in order to be completed. You have to provide a triggering event to make the students explore, integrate, and then have the resolution where learners apply the newly gained knowledge to educational context or workplace settings. But if you try to combine them, the social presence and the cognitive presence, there will be the desirable exchange. So you will have both of them. And of course, these two elements cannot do without the teaching presence. Activities comprising this category include that the instructors must recreate PowerPoint presentations, develop mini lectures, or provide some personal insight into the course material. But when we have to do with online courses, the instructor must address the need to diagnose comments for accurate understanding, inject sources of information, direct discussions in forums, scaffold the learners, and they generally must facilitate reflection and discourse by presenting more content according to the learner's needs and use various means of assessment and feedback. So instructors must have both content and pedagogical expertise to make links among contributed ideas, diagnose misperceptions, and inject knowledge from textbooks, articles, and web-based materials. That's why this role is associated with sharing meaning, identifying areas of agreement and disagreement, and seeking to reach consensus and understanding. So you can understand that although it is very difficult to follow these guidelines, they are a guarantee that you're going to have a quality and very successful course. And that's all for me.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anastasia. I would like to invite Felipe to continue and share his screen.
Thank you all. In fact, hello, good evening to all. And thank you for your time and participation on this little course. My name is Felipe Londoño, and I'm a pedagogical advisor of Buen Data. We are a Colombian company of e-learning development. And we're going to present you a little software that attached to the presentation, the wonderful presentation that Anna just made, that Anastasia just made, no? By firsthand, thank you for the presentation, Anna. It was wonderful. This is a little showcase, and in fact, on how can technology and learning tools can be integrated with these theories and these pedagogic models that are such important step in the education and the construction of learning routes, no? For the students. We are Data Curso. We want to present you. In fact, it's a software, a system we are developing in an alpha state that is gonna help the automatization and creation of the instructional design of a course, you know, by taking some elements and tools using a conditional form, a conditional format system app. It's a form based on conditional logics that will propose the teacher the resources and learning materials, of course, for blended and e-learning to make automated design, instructional design multimedia script. We're planning the software in two states. First, the desktop software that is gonna be developed, of course, full responsibly, compatible with all browsers and with the, all the WACG standard, accessibility standard requirements, no? And a mobile version that is, think for Android and Google app and Huawei Play Store. Some of the features we are presenting on the software will be based, of course, as I was saying, in conditional logic guidance. This means that some of the answers that the teacher gives to the system will open or select some content. You know, basically the answers depends and open future phases of the form that will change in the way of the contents that the teacher is selecting. I'm going to show you a little showcase right on the way. It's based on educational standards because we developed the app and the selection of contents and questions based on pedagogic models. You know, we used some pedagogic models and instructional design standards to present these questions in the form. It will be ready for production because in the first version, we are going to present in August, we are developing a multimedia script, as I was saying you, with the instructional design of the course, with the answers and the information condensed. And the idea is that in near future, it's gonna be able to uploaded in the Moodle platform as an MVC archive and be and let the automatization of the course creation. That's why it's gonna have a teacher autonomy in the creation process of these answers that the teacher is gonna give to the form. It's gonna have the liberty of the selection, and we're trying to make the teacher think deeply in this content creation process and these objectives and goals of the course. That's why also is based on rubric design process and in a rubric design base, you know? Because the teacher needs to allow himself and the system to measure how close he will be with the learning objectives and the proposition of the courses. That's why, Data Curso will be powered by a robust teacher and content creator community that will give us the feedback via forums, via a web that will let us in the building process to create the software using the considerations of all these learning community. As I was saying you, we are planning this in three main stages. The first one is the version 1.0, the development of this media of this multimedia script that is based on a PDF in the first stage that will condense all the content, all the inquiries and all the specifications that the teacher is making in this form. It will be presented as a report that in the second stage, in the version 2.0, will be supposed to get the integration with Moodle LMS and upload it to the platform. So the course or this mock-up of the course with all the activities you need, with all the resources that you must use, it's gonna be uploaded instantly. That's the expectation. You know, and the last but not least, the stage of development that is like our goal, our main goal is the integration of this dynamic script with content and learning resource databases. You know, we are talking about lectures, SCORMs, micro learning, MOOCs, and all the resources associated to this construction process and to this like. Multimedia script. The idea is to offer the teacher also the possibility of a selection of a pool of contents, you know, that will be suited because of the audience, because of the age of the audience, because all of these important stages that he will be filling out in the form. As you will see, we have some stages based on some functionalities that we are planning based on Gagne's model to fulfill this all this information that needs the course to be accomplished. These are like we can basically divide this in like eight main stages. That are based. First, on an introduction, where we're gonna need like the diagnostic, where we're gonna need some information of the course and the audience. This is vital because the audience and the teacher and the context is where the course is going to take place. Every aspect of the course of this like diagnostic phase or this social phase implies because the every aspect counts, the learning path, the age of the students, the academic level, the access to technological resources, everything is important to get in touch of the resources we are going to use to get this information. Because of the access of the technology, you gotta use different materials, different learning activities or resources. Not everyone is in the same mediation with the technology. So the appropriation of these learning contents depends entirely of the resources and tools the teacher is using. So we need to know the context in a very, very deeply way, to fulfill the contextual reality of these technological resources, of this use of technology and the platform. It's in fact like a research, like a first research of the learner and the student and the teacher, of course. It is constructed in a way we can show a vital point around the easy access to these technologies. We gotta show the teacher that he must think in this access to these maybe tools or resources that the student can get. Of course, we are thinking, maybe in our country, in some countries that the development of technology is not so well constructed. So this will ultimately prevent the appropriation of the contents and the section will deeply contextualize the teacher in the recognition of those chosen material and technological tools. We pass for the introduction where we're gonna like take all the generalities of the course. You know, this is where we'll build in the process, the formal process begins, where we need an introduction, the purpose, the course title, the goals, the learning objectives and topics, and of course the length and the division of the course. We propose, of course, by models, and how is going to be this division. We stop here to recall the importance of the previous knowledge. We build these sections based on Ausbo, and what Anastasia was explaining is the importance to reach out the information about the previous knowledge that the student have and what he's going to expect to learn in this course. So the form can make these associations, yeah, of the previous knowledge of the previous knowledge that the student must have, maybe, or that is expected to have to start the course. And how is this going to be reflection or a reflection of the learning goals and how he's going to learn by this previous knowledge and this like elaboration of the new contents, how he's changing his learning path, you know? So, and this building a model selection, we selected the Gagne's face model to fulfill, in fact, all the data collation based in these eight stages. Based on these stages proposed originally by Gagne, we expect the teacher to fulfill all the information that is gonna be important in that moment of the phases. As we can see, the conditional logic will be based on these decisions that are put on every one of these phases. So the expectation, maybe it's gonna be around the question motivation of the teacher to build up the engagement and curiosity. You know, we build up around the importance of three methodologies of construction. These eight phases are based on three methodologies of construction. And these three methodologies are like the core for the activities and the resources. Depending of the one of the three selections the teacher made in one of the phases, if he selects maybe the model is going to be with constructivism or conductivism of cognitivism, it will be proposed with different materials and resource and activities to select in subsequent phases. So maybe I want a traditional behavioral conductism methodology for one of my models. So that will be attached to some specific activities and resources for the course. That is the conditional model logic we are planning on data course. So by these phases, that the first one is motivation and expectations, we're gonna build up the curiosity. We wanna elaborate a question that encourages the student to learn the course contents. We're gonna pass an apprehension and attention phase that according to Gagne, it allows us to identify the learning objectives and generate expectations of what is about to come, you know, to make the course attractive by using some, I don't know, techniques, maybe history telling, some kind of that. The acquisition encoding phase is important so we can get an association of the previous knowledge with the knowledge exposed in the construction of the model, as I was saying. And the memory retention, where we're going to expose all these learning objectives associated with the learning resources and activities that will get memory retention and engagement with the study. The presentations, the lectures, all the things that the teacher could use in this phase. Yeah, that is totally attached with the information and retrieval phase, where the teacher must get guidance and support to the students using strategies and analogies, examples, and the generalization and transfer information phase, where the teacher is gonna give the access to the student to make his own path and to express the learning content he just reached. So based on these six phases, we proposed, if I may ask you a little bit time, to show you the little form we got here in an alpha state. So maybe after this little speech, you can show in a very basic way, in a first way, what are we trying to do? So this is the first alpha model of a Data Curso form. As I was saying you, we are trying to get a very, very deep knowledge of the audience of this course in the first time, in the first phase, in the diagnostic phases. You know, we're gonna recollect all the information we can about the technological skills, how we can use these technological skills, the consideration of the level of academics of the teacher and of the learners, the importance of the knowledge of some aspects of the organization. You know, this is built like with a model course I just created to show a little bit of example. We can just make, you know, maybe if you don't need other type of achievements, you will always have some conditional options that are proposed by the system. And always you can select something that is not there. You know, you must say, how is the contribution of the course of the achieving goals to the organization? You know, we propose that here is a process where the teacher must think a lot of this process of creation of the goals, of he's really what he's expecting, so the system can get all the data in a very specific way. So this we propose also a specific instructions of the course, maybe something that it must have, it must do. Yeah. We are very specific also in the technological resources and the human resources maybe the teams have. Something that happens very with the content creation and the instructional design in the case of some companies is that the process is made by some external team. You know, the process is that the content or the teacher or the association or the company gives these directors of these directorates to the companies or to a content creator company to make these formation plans. And so we want to know if the company also have these resources to construct the course. Of course, if he's going to use an LMS and a specific intentions and instructions to the use of this LMS, this is where the conditional logic happens. Maybe you are not going to use system conference audio. Everything is around the necessities of the teacher. You know, maybe he's going to use Zoom, Google Meets, or another video conference. All the communication channels that he's going to use, we propose a series of communication channels, you know, and the intranet and the internal communication channels of the companies, plagiarism technologies. As you can see, everything is very, very, we want to have deep information of this construction of the course. Accessibility standards, what are the technologies that the course is using or it will be gonna use? Just think about is the expectation of this is, as I was saying, you to upload this to Moodle and to have this automatization in a way that the teacher doesn't have to do this on Moodle, doesn't have to do this on any kind of platform, and the system it will be able to read this in an intelligent form, so the platform can access to this information just by filling out the form. You know, of course, the importance of the easily of the obtainable technologies, as I was saying you, it is vital to know it is easy or hard to the students to get to the technologies, and if it's hard, we must offer alternatives and solutions to this fulfillment of the process, you know, and not everyone is going to be able to use a computer. So we gotta ask the teacher to what happened to this student, to this person that doesn't have all the resources, all the tools. We have some the importance of the student support, where the tutoring and accompaniment is going to happen, and the significant prospection is we put the teacher here in a very important path where he's going to really see what is going to improve and what is the performance that the course is giving to these students. You know, the prospection is what, basically what the course is going to give, what is going to learn, and in what is the improvement of opportunity or improvement that the students is going to learn. Everything is related, as I was saying you, to the previous knowledge, to these previous knowledges and these future knowledges that are shown in next phases. You know, in the generalities phases, as you see, you're going to see the options to create the full name of your course, the purpose of your course, and the learning goals. This is deeply important also to be a part and to make the teacher to really land in what he's going to expect of his class. You know, it is like a very deeply creation process with the teacher, and of course how many models he's going to have. The app is expected, as now is happening, to work with 4 models. We are expecting to make it the models that really the teacher wants, and the length of the course expressed in hours. You know, and here, as you see, we're going to have a very most deep information of the course in terms of hours, the grading. Everything is going to be assessed with Moodle again. This is going to be read by Moodle. So the numerical scales, the grades, the technological requirements for the student, or if it has a special tutors, maybe it's a very complex course in, I don't know, data programming or something. Well, the student needs a very powerful computer. It is going to have in these conditionals the different tutors that the teacher must configure to the students know previously that they need a powerful computer, or they don't really need extra filters, or they just need a computer with mobile device and internet. It is a total consideration of the teacher. Here is the important part of this previous knowledge. We are offering the possibility to the teacher to attach the previous knowledges that the student must have and must know previous to the beginning of the course, so the data can make the correlation between the new knowledge and the previous knowledge. As I was telling you, this is algo theory applied to a technological tool, to a technological resource. As you can see, I proposed different examples of this consideration of these previous knowledges, and of course the name of the teacher that will be presented in the course. When we got all this information, we can start the model assessment and the model construction based on these 3 pedagogical models I was telling you back on the presentation. When you select one of these 3 models, what are you gonna get? If I allow you, so you can see, you will be presented with a series of different considerations regarding the pedagogical model you are using. As you can see, the traditional model will offer a bunch of, or a toolbox of learning objects that differ from the cognoscitivism. And like that, you're gonna select, of course, it's important to know that every model can be a different pedagogical model. And we are open in our future forums to make these new or to propose new pedagogical models for the selection of the construction to these models. And of course, the interpretation skills, or the skills that is gonna learn this student in the in the process of learning. When he starts, when the teacher starts to feel this specific information on these phases that I just explained, he will fulfill all the information that the system needs, you know? Maybe the declarative objectives or the attitudinal, if we're talking about a technology course, of course will be executional objectives, you know, that carry out with practice or skills or procedural objectives with the use of the platform that are attached obviously to this construction or this pedagogical construction. This will, this is not really helping the teacher to know what he's gonna, what are his objectives, but just simply to make easy the automatization of this data. We in fact are encouraging to think deeply in these associations. Because the data, of course, it is not well, it will not work if it is not think in a previous phase, these learning objectives and paths. As you can see, these acquisition phases will allow the teacher to make the associations from one previous knowledge to a new knowledge that is referenced in the objectives of the learn. Here are the previous knowledge we just put in the diagnostic space where we knew our audience. And here are the new knowledges that we are going to associate with our learning activities and materials. In that way, we construct this with this consideration or this pedagogical consideration of the learning objects. Of course, continuing with the structurization or the structured way and the logical sequences of the general concepts and the topics that will have the class. The general concepts that will be use of platform or Moodle appropriation, or whatever the teacher has consideration that describes his course. His this memory or recovery or recall phase, we deeply encourage the teacher to give us the strategies and analogies and use of examples and demonstrations to these types or these concepts and definitions he is just proposing up there. You know, the deep knowledge maybe is related to some theories or academic research that he is going to use in this content creation in this course. That is important to the student to know, or maybe just simple deep information of the topic. We propose these different options to the teacher to make a robust consideration and make a robust construction of these learning objects. And this generalization phase and transfer, as you know, how are we gonna transfer the knowledge by real cases? How is the student knowing that he's learning, in fact, that the contents that he's approaching are usable? Well, the understanding of the topic is basically it's attached to these real cases, real experiments, real consideration in reality that is showing the student the real application of the course. You know, it's the best guidance, like real examples. And as you see, the learning and activity resources are attached to the pedagogical models. These are the basic resources that we're gonna see in an LMS, of course, focused in Moodle. We are trying to make this Moodle friendly in the first hand. So you're gonna see these, the most used resource and activities or all the activities and resources you can use in the platform. With the with the resources like books, labels, folders, photographs, all the multimedia information resources attached with the all activities and grading activities the student is gonna use in the course. Of course, the teacher will select what he will use, and the Moodle automatically will upload these activities to the course. The last mission of response phase is based on this execution and to make the teacher to practice, to make the student to practice and provide this information of this learning results, you know, how he learned, or if the learning was approached in the right way, is gonna be shown in these two phases and in the last phase that is called the evaluation phase. Maybe with the retention of the learning contents in the retention phase, we proposed a long-term activity that can show the students how he is attached to this learned content, you know, and in the evaluation phase, you're gonna get no teacher feedback. It is just the criteria to construct the quizzes and the instrumentalization of this evaluation method. What is gonna be the evaluation criteria, an exam, a thesis, or whatever you wanna use, see? Or whatever indicator or a skill indicator you are engaging in the course. You take the test, you make the additional instructions to the test and the evaluation criteria, and maybe you can select how many criteria of evaluation you are using in the in this last phase. With the all the information condensed, yeah, in a multimedia script, you're gonna save this information. And as I was saying, you the first consideration we have is that we expect to get a report that could be downloaded with all the information that the data just fulfill, that we expect to, of course, will be uploaded with the information to Moodle in an MVC format, where you upload this, the platform or the plugin we are developing is gonna read all this information that is, of course, condensed in a PDF report, and will finally will be attached to a new course or a new model in the LMS. Like as I was saying, you this is the first version of the software. We expect to this be attached to contents to support the share of databases, of content databases with a SCORM and libraries that are attached to the resources and activities. So the teacher can have a database of even of the resources based on this audience, you know, because everything is constructed from the audience, from this diagnostic phase. So the resources and activities will be proposed using this consideration of the audience and the mediation with the technology. This is like the state of the app that we are developing. I hope it is of course, sorry, I didn't tell you, we got a pre-registration form in the page. I'm gonna send you via the chat. So we, as I was saying, we expect to have a very, very important feedback with the community of the teachers. We are building this from the alpha state with the help of the teachers. And here in our main page, datacurso.com, you will be able to make a pre-registration. Yeah, it's a very simple landing page where you're gonna get the information and you're gonna get a pre-registration, maybe a feedback of this presentation of you. Just see you can give us your comments. We will be very, very thankful if you want to give us feedback, because we are building this with a community of teachers that you can be part in, and of course we want you to be part. We just sent you the email the page in the chat. So maybe this is all. I hope you have liked it. And again, Anastasia, thank you. It was a very wonderful presentation. I hope this attached to what you just show, and I hope the participants you just like it and hope to use the system, you know, in a future. We are expect to release this software on August of this year, the first version of the software. So we are gonna give you, like in Moodle, we're gonna give you all the news in this Moodle Academy, and with Moodle, we are Moodle partners. So we are gonna give you contact on this release. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Felipe. Thank you so much, Anastasia. We have extended the hour a lot, but it has been a really impressive presentation. And what an amazing collaboration between Greece and Colombia. It's a complete presentation on instructional design. I know that I will be returning back to this recording to review to this presentation again and again. And I'm looking forward to see Data Corso and use Data Corso in action. You know, I've already started playing around with it. I'm really impressed you have already in English, an English version. This means that you work quite fast on this project, and that's really great. I'm going through the chat. We have some questions. I'm trying to find lots of compliments for both presentations. I do remember there was a question about the price of Data Corso. If you can please answer this one, Felipe. It's gonna be a price, it's gonna be how people will be able to use Data Corso.
Yeah, of course. Well, we are planning, of course, we are in Moodle. We are, of course, planning a free version of the software. In fact, we don't have prices yet, but we can assure you we're gonna have a free version. We're gonna have a free version. Maybe we're gonna expect some kind of pricing plan. Maybe the number of instructional designs you can make on the platform. That is gonna, maybe the pricing will gonna go by that, the number of instructional designs. But in fact, we're gonna have a very, very free version to everyone. It is a fact.
Thank you. Thank you so much for clarifying this. Great news, I think, for all of us. Kenzie made a comparison between Data Corso and ABC Learning Design, and Sam has already answered this one, as he says that I think it does a bit more than the learning designer too, because it encourages designers to conduct more rigorous analysis, while the ABC Learning Designer assumes that this work has been already conducted, and I totally agree with this. We have several comments about people that would love to use Data Corso in action. Especially the corporate environment or learning organizations where instructional designers come directly with no prior knowledge, without having in mind all those great things that Anastasia talked about, that will be really useful.
In fact, we think a lot, like as I was saying, that like maybe this instructional design is made now by a teams of creators, of e-learning creators that are not attached to the organizations at all. They don't know anyone there. So this is very, very, they will attach the with the real people and what is happening in the organizations, you know. It's important. And it's 100% customizable and personalization to the, of course, to the person and or the organization that acquired Data Curso in a massive way. It is going to be 100% fully customizable. You know, it is a tailored experience for each of the organizations.
Excellent. I think we need, unfortunately, to wrap up and just to close this session. Sorry for being out of time, and thank you for staying here that long. If you are happy with the webinars and information shared through the Moodle Academy webinars, you may get involved and get us grow by contributing to its development. You may suggest topic ideas to be converted in future webinars and courses by joining our Get Involved course. You can contribute to webinars and present a webinar in Moodle Academy. Keep in mind that webinar presenters will get a badge from Moodle Academy, and you can also contribute to courses. You can share your expertise, and also course contributors will receive a course builder badge. And of course, you can also help us by spreading the word. Tell your friends and colleagues about Moodle Academy and the Moodle Educator Certificate. You can come in Moodle Academy, take courses and earn a badge. You can certainly tell others and show off your badges. And if you are an educator and you have extended experience in teaching with Moodle, you might be interested to take the Moodle Educator Certification. And you can take a quiz to check if you are ready from the Academy. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm looking forward to see you in another webinar here in Moodle Academy.